people here. Today I'm going to discuss about the clinical side of the thalassemia disorders, how to manage the thalassemia. As I know that you are quite expert in the genetic side, so we'll discuss about the clinical side of the thalassemia, clinical management and its related disorder. We all know the thalassemia is basically a globin chain disorder where there is an underproduction of any one of the globin chain that led to the is an anemia, and as well as the ineffective chain which increased production and led to the hemolysis. So we have, and this is one of the largest monogenic disorder which affect around the 1 to 2% of the population. The incidence rate is varies from the area to area. It's an around 1 to 30%. The most common prevalent this is genetic disorder is in the Southeast Asia, then the South Asia and the Indians, and as well as the Middle East and the Sardinia area, where their incidence rates ranging between the 10 to 15%, while it's very unusual and rare in the Northern Europe as well as in the Scandinavian countries. And so with this incidence, around 100 to 200 million population are affected with the beta thalassemia. What I'm saying is an trait as well as the beta thalassemia major. So there is one study recently, it was published in some year back. It's done by the Professor Salam Kandi, where he has done a study on the more than 7,000 neonatal sample. He found out the incidence of, here if you look at the alpha globin chain, which is almost around 50%. While the beta thalassemia itself is the disorder trait is around 2.6%. Sickle cell is around 4.8, and the remaining of the hemoglobin E, D, and C is around 1%. So this is one of the study of their own, and this and these are some of the chains disorder. Regarding the alpha chain disorder, we have the alpha thalassemia trait. As you all know that whether we have the actually four genes present in the alpha thalassemia. So if it's a one or two gene deleted, that led to this homozygous or heterozygous alpha thalassemia trait. While we have the hemoglobin constant spring as well as an hemoglobin H, where the three genes are deleted. While the Bart's hemoglobin is very unusual, led to the in utero death, you have the total absence of the alpha gene. Beta chain disorder, we have the homozygous and heterozygous beta thalassemia, where one of the two genes are affected or both are affected. Hemoglobin S is then point mutations, as well as in hemoglobin D and E, C. These are few of the beta chain disorder. Then we have the delta thalassemia and alpha beta, or alpha delta thalassemia, so beta delta thalassemia, HPFH. These are the other disorders. These are the mutation analysis is there. There is also one study recently is also published in the from the SQH, where they done the mutation analysis. They found in the thalassemia around 30 mutation were found in Oman. Out of these, 11 are quite common. Well, at our center, we found is an IVS intervening sequence 1 to 5 is the common thalassemia gene mutations. Overall, we have an around 300 mutations in the world. So it's an only is in 20 to 30 genes are most commonly involved, which is carrying the 80% of the thalassemia abnormalities. This is especially the 619 base pair deletion, especially found in the southern India. We found in the Middle East and Mediterranean populations, as well as in some state in Pakistan as well, around 5 to 6% we have the thalassemia trait, whereas in inter IVS 1 to 5 is the most common genetic abnormalities. As I said earlier, this thalassemia is not is an heterogeneous disorder with various clinical manifestation. On the one hand, we have the homozygous beta thalassemia major, which require the blood transfusion. The other hand, we have the thalassemia intermedia as well as the heterozygous thalassemia, which have only microcytic anemia, might not require the blood transfusion per se. So these are there are different interaction between the genes. So how they affect each other, we have like in the alpha gene concurrent, if patient who have a beta thalassemia with concurrent alpha thalassemia, one or two gene deletions, so it lessen the symptoms, it might ameliorate, because now we have the decrease uncoupled or decreased production of the alpha chain as well. So we have the less uncoupling of the alpha tetramer and the hemichrome hemolysis, as well as if on the other end, if we have an excess alpha chain instead of an 4, if we have an 5 genes, so even in the thalassemia minor might behave just like as in thalassemia intermedia. So we can see how the alpha thalassemia is modified the is the clinical phenotype of the thalassemia. This, as well as there are some variation in the gamma chain, especially XMNL gene polymorphism, which led to the switch on of the gamma chain. So there is an increased production of the hemoglobin F. So that also might decrease the sign and symptom in the beta thalassemia. Then we have secondary modifiers. These are the genes which are not linked with the beta chain abnormality, but those are the abnormality which can increase or worsen the complications of the beta thalassemia. Especially one of these one is the bilirubin metabolism gene, the UGT-A1A, which is led to the bilirubin oxidation and metabolism if it is an absent, like in the Gilbert syndrome. So if it's absent in the beta thalassemia, so it can cause the worsening of the hyperbilirubinemia, and we have an increased incidence of the gallstone. So, and we have some other genes, iron metabolism, especially if patient have an beta thalassemia with concurrent HFE mutation, like CA2A2Y mutation or H63D mutations, that further increase the iron overload and iron-related complication, especially cardiac sidrosis, as well as the liver iron hemosidrosis. Cardiac diseases, especially if when lipoprotein A abnormalities with this gene, so the cardiac disease become more pronounced or appear early in the age, and some other HLA haplotype, osteoporosis more pronounced if patient have the thalassemia with concurrent vitamin D receptor deficiency. Sorry. Now come back to this one, is then the clinical and the laboratory features. How this patient behave? Generally, thalassemia, these patients who have the thalassemia, they presented with an early age, generally after, not in the neonatal period, after the age of the 6 months, the period failure to thrive, poor feeding, diarrhea, and the skeletal deformities. They have an also borderline low hemoglobin. And then I can show you here, if you look at the blood film, this is the real of a patient, one of who have the, if you look at the blood film, is majority of it showing is in microcytic hypochromic cells. And there are also is a lot of variety. You can say the poikilocyte, teardrops, there is a blister cell, fragmented RBC, everything you can find in the blood film in the thalassemia patient. If this is the patient with the homozygous beta thalassemia, also as well as the nucleated RBCs and basophilic stippling. While is the definite diagnosis on the HP electrophoresis are, as well as the high performance liquid chromatography that you can find in thalassemia major is then absence of the hemoglobin A. You have the raised hemoglobin F as well as the hemoglobin A2. This is quite interesting, isn't it? As we thought about that in the beta thalassemia major, the whole problem anemia is due to the underproduction. This is not the case. Actually, this is an anemia and the thalassemia is a multifactorial. It's the most important cause is due to the ineffective erythropoiesis. If you look at the excess free alpha globin gene, right now this alpha globin gene is not coupled with the beta chain due to the underproduction or the absence of the beta chain. So it's formed a tetramer that led to the hemichrome and the intramedullary hemolysis, intramedullary hemolysis that led to the ineffective erythropoiesis. At the same simultaneously, once this ineffective erythropoiesis is happening, sorry, I'm just isn't focusing on this area. It's because if it is an if like this one, then there is an increase in erythropoietin stimuli is there. So we have the extramedullary hemopoiesis there. So that led to the increase in the bone marrow expansion as well as the splenomegaly. That further led to the sequestration of the RBC, further worsening of the anemia. So this is the hallmark how this happening, this multifactorial level led to the anemia in the thalassemia patient. Now is the management. Isn't the key component of the thalassemia management is it's not an as an it's actually need a dedicated comprehensive care units. Ideally, it should be in thalassemia unit. It should be dedicated in the major hospitals. The patient who are having a diagnosis with the beta thalassemia major, which I hope they are registered in the inherited blood disorder, as well as they are registered in that particular institute where they are getting the transfusions as well, transfusion support. So we have the registrations in our, in Royal Hospital, we have the two units, the pediatric and the adult units, they are treating the thalassemia. So these, we have the database of these patients are there. And so this is how we can do is the, as I said, the anemia is one of the commonest, one of the major issues early on in the thalassemia patient. So how to tackle these issues of the anemia? So first thing first we will see is then, what was the, yes, is an anemia should be managed in the thalassemia by giving the transfusion, blood transfusion. But what is the our goal of the blood transfusion? Why we want to give the blood transfusion? This not only, this is not only to improve the hemoglobin and oxygen supply, but at the same time, we want to give the transfusion to decrease their own erythropoiesis, endogenous, because that I led to you, earlier told you, this ineffective erythropoiesis led to the multiple complications, splenomegaly and the skeletal deformities, as well as we have to promote the normal healthy lifestyle of the patient as well. Generally, our transfusion target in the thalassemia major patient is the little bit higher than the conventional patient. We keep the pre-transfusion hemoglobin around 9 to 10 gram, and the post-transfusion it should not exceed the 14 gram, it should be around 13 gram. So this is called some sort of the super transfusion, and they require more blood transfusion in thalassemia. So this is how it's ideally it should be done, that how this, before starting the transfusion, what we have to do these to these patients. We must registered this patient, and we must, those, once we identify the patient that this is the patient who is going to get the transfusion, there are certain criteria for this patient, then we have to do the full red cell phenotype, which including not only the ABO but full RH phenotype, including the big C, D and the E, as well as the KL phenotype. And we have to screen for the hepatitis B and C like any other patient who is getting the transfusion, and vaccination against hepatitis B if they were not previously vaccinated. And the blood product, ideally they should receive the packed RBC transfusion, which should be universally liquid depleted. But we are not doing it here. It's ideally actually this liquid depleted blood, it will decrease the transfusion transmitted complication, especially the febrile non-hemolytic transfusion reaction. And the transfusion interval is between the 2 to 4 weeks. And risk of fellow immunization, well, this various studies shows this risk of the any patient who is getting multiple transfusion, the yellow immunization risk is between 7 to 30%. I just come across one of the study from my colleague in the blood bank from the SQH. She just have a retrospective analysis, and they just found that the risk of allo immunization here is an only 1%, which is because of the, we have the pre-transfusion workup with the extended phenotype. So generally we are giving the
immunization information of the antibody
against the transfused RBC. So because if you generally only, if you do the ABO and the RH groups, we have some other minor antigens are also available. Since this patient getting the multiple transfusion, so they are might prone to the some unusual antigens like in small C, small E, big E, F, Duffy, KL. So they develop the antibody against it. So this is a big problem. But in thalassemia major, even in our experience, we do not come across is an allo immunization. It's a more problem with the sickle cell disease where there is an impaired immunity and the patient develop the more problem, especially in the sickle cell disease patient rather than in the thalassemia. Thalassemia intermedia is one condition where you can also have the risk of allo immunization. Yeah, this is one of the major complications. It's a long-term late complication of the transfusions that led to the transfusion siderosis, iron overload in the patients. So this is an how is, as I already told you, regarding if you look at the iron regulators, iron hemostasis, how in the body is iron is being absorbed and how that led to it. So the transfusion of the packed RBC is only one factor. But there is in our body, we have the endogenous circulation, ineffective erythropoiesis that led to the increase in the iron absorption from the body as well compared to the normal. Normal people, we just get the only 1 to 2 milligram iron absorption, while in the ineffective erythropoiesis due to the any of the hemoglobinopathy disorder, the absorption might increase 5 to 6 times. On top of that, if you are getting the transfusion, so that led to the further increase in the iron. So this calculation is an, cumbersome calculation. We just know is an roughly that 1 unit of the packed RBC around content 200 milligram of iron. So that you can calculate that how much iron we are getting. Suppose a patient who is getting 13, 14 transfusions in 1 year time. So you know that is an, the volume is around is an 4,800 milligram of iron. If you calculate by the milligram per kilogram, so per day, that around will be around 0.3 to 0.4 milligram per kilogram, which is quite high, around 9 to 10 milligram per day. That will be the volume. So this toxicity of the iron that led to the multiple organ failures, as well as is the short term, especially the non-transferent binding iron, that is we call the labile plasma iron, iron which is not bind to the any of the protein. So this is an iron led to the deoxidation of the lipid membrane, DNA damage to the DNA and causing the fibrosis. So this is the most lethal iron, which is the free reactive iron that led to the damage to the tissues. This is how we monitor, the patient who have at risk of iron overload. So all we know is the serum ferritin is an, is a very easily, widely available, inexpensive test, and is an, you can do it, the repeat measurement is there. And it's having actually is a positive correlation when is the serum ferritin level is very low, less than 2500. So it's having very good linear correlation with the total body iron store. Once the level is become more than 3000, so it's very difficult to judge whether how much is patient have an iron store. The disadvantage is an indirect method, and it's an fluctuate widely, especially if patient have an ongoing infection, inflammation or the liver damage. So that might lead to the increase in the ferritin, which is not the true representative of the total body iron store. So this is the liver iron concentration measurement. This is one of the direct method where we have to take the liver biopsy and measure it. So this is the very reference standard. Now all our other parameters. So this is our reference technique from where we measure the total body iron store. As we said, is very, you know, it's an invasive procedures, and it's an you have to do the biopsy, so you need a lot of complication, and you have a morbidity and mortality about it. So it's not being used nowadays more commonly until and unless you are doing some research studies as well. But this is still the gold standard and the reference standard where we compare with all other measuring method. Magnetic resonance imaging, MRI assessment, that is the novel technique. Nowadays we are using the special technique T2 star MRI or R2 star MRI, which is measure the iron content in the heart and the liver. This is an readily available, is an almost all the major institute, they have the T2 star MRI available. Even in the Oman, we have the two centers who are having this one special MRI. So it have the other advantages, and it's measure the both liver as well as the heart iron. And the only disadvantage is an, it's an indirect method. It's an, also is the technically demanding. It's needed certain specific software and the training. You have to interpret these data. The only thing about the MRI T2 star, I can tell you, when we have the severe iron overload, so the our T2 star reading, it will be the low. So the our iron burden start once we have the MRI reading is in less than 20 milliseconds. That is we call the patient have an iron overload, whether it's in the liver or at the heart. If it is less than 5 milliseconds, which is the relaxation time of the T2 star, it's showing a very severe iron overload, which demand urgent attention, whether in the heart or in the liver. So this is then, this is also quite reproducible, and you're just monitoring the efficacy of your treatment with this T2 stuff. It's like I said, that from 20 milliseconds and below, with this it shows that there is, and you have the total, you have the iron accumulation in your body is there. So below 10 is a moderate iron overload. Generally, is in 5 to 10 milligram per kilogram dry weight. That is with the liver iron concentration that you can correlate with. But below 5 millisecond, it means it's a severe iron overload, where you have the iron concentration is more than 15 milligram per gram of dry weight of the liver. So the low the level, low the readings, high the iron burden is there. Other method which we don't right now is not routinely used is an urinary iron estimation, when you give the desferoxamine and collect the urine and estimate the iron excretion, and some other is the technique not readily available and not validated. Now we come back to this management about the iron chelations. So we have a different iron chelation agents are available. It's an, we have it's the desferoxamine. This is the it's the drug which is in, since used from the 1970 onwards, so it's in around 40-50 years, with having very good safety profile. It's very efficacious in removing the iron from both heart and the liver. The only problem is that this drug is only available in the injectable form, because it cannot be absorbed from the GI tract, and very short half-life is only 30 minutes. So it should be given in a continuous infusions. So that's the only little drawback of this one, desferoxamine. And this is how we are using the dose, is the around 50 to 60 in the adult. This drug is very safe in the pregnancy. You can use in the second and third trimester. So this is the added advantage about this drug is there. IV desferoxamine, that generally we don't use, but it's used in those particular group of patients where you have the persistently high serum ferritin despite of patient is on the subcut serum ferritin, or patient who have very high LIC, I told you is more than 15 milligram per kilogram, or significant patient have a heart disease, cardiac arrhythmia, or is the poor ejection fractions, or patient prior to the transplant as well as the pregnancy, where you need a vigorous IV iron chelations in order to optimize the patient for these procedures. So that we have to use. This is how the dose calculation is. Desferal. Yeah, that we call as a desferal. Desferoxamine is desferal. The other drug is the defriprone, is an oral iron chelating agent that we are using since 1980 for the last 3 decades. This is the only advantage, is an oral iron chelating agent. This is a small molecule readily absorbed from the GI tract. Half-life is around 4 hours, so that's why we have to take it TID. That's a little bit problem. The more problem with this is then it can cause the severe agranulocytosis, neutropenia, and the arthropathy. So that should be closely monitored when any of these patients who are on the defriprone. We have one patient, she developed this one, is the neutropenia, and then we have to discontinue. As well as the arthropathy, is, as I told you, this mainly is the larger joint, especially in the knee. So one of our patients, she developed the crippling deformation, this one arthropathy of the knee, and she is unable to walk. Once we stop, then she slowly, gradually recover, but it takes time. So this is a little bit problem with the defriprone. And also the adherence is a major issue with this drug. This is not suitable in the pregnancy. This is a new, it's an iron chelating agent, we call it the XJ or the Defresrox. That's the advantage is and once daily, because they have the longer half-life, around 12 to 14 hours. This drug is still safe and efficacious, but still we can't use in the pregnancy. The usually started doses, and we start from the 20 milligram and we go up to the 40 milligram per kilogram per day. So this is the, there are certain problem with this drug, especially is then it led to the increase in the creatinine. So it's closely monitor the side effect of this.
How often after the first dose you will monitor?
Before starting the XJET, we have to do the 2 reading of the urea electrolyte creatinine clearance. And then is then at least 2 weeks after this one, okay. After 2 or 3 months, then as an on every visit you have to monitor with the creatinine clearance. If it is an, it's not only is the level is raised, but if it's if it is even the level is within normal range but is increased from the baseline, then you have to be very careful about it. So increase in 25% baseline level give you an idea that it might go patient into a renal failure. So you can adjust the dose, you can discontinue depending upon it, and you might re-challenge the patient with a lower dose later on. But general recommendation is then you should not use the dose below 20 milligram if patient have a severe iron overload. So you can decrease the dose up to the 20 milligram. After that, if his patient is still having the symptom, then you have to discontinue, because then below 20 milligram per kilogram, it's not very effective. Yeah. Yeah, that I can now is in combinations. Is in combination therapy one we use when patient failed with the monotherapy. So which combination is the best? Different studies are going on. But regarding the desferoxamine and the defropin combination, there are many studies which is showing is the combination of these two drugs have a very synergistic effect, and it is an very effective in removing the labile plasma iron as well as the iron from the heart, with improvement in the heart function and improvement in the T2 star MRI. So this combination is quite good and quite safe, these two drugs. Regarding the desferoxamine and the defrosrox combination is going on a study. I do not at present time come across. We are also using the combination, but a different way. We using the 3 days, 4 days sort of thing. Like 3 days desferoxamine and the 4 days defrosrox, like this combination. So it's still we don't encounter. So study wise, the is the defriprone defrosrox is the standard. Is proven that it's more effective in removing iron from the heart. Okay. About these combination, later combinations is still going on. So it's showing some improvement, but that is already proven, the combination, the previous later combination. These are some recent publications in 2013 that we know is the defriprone versus defrosrox in beta thalassemia, major in the early 20s. So this is also from the SQH recent studies. Non-inferiority, it's showing, and there is, and both drugs are quite efficacious in decreasing the serum ferritin as well as the improvement in the liver iron concentration. Decrease the liver iron concentration and improve the T2 star MRI. There are other studies. Especially regarding the XJ studies in the cardiac T2 star, like in Cordillo study as well as in the IPIC studies, these trials showing that this is an XJ is an comparable with the desferoxamine in term of removing of the iron from the heart, improving the ejection fraction and improving the T2 star MRI in all group of the patient, whether they are severely iron overloaded or mild iron overloaded. They also brought the serum ferritin. So is a non-inferiority, is not superior, but it's comparable with the desferoxamine. Now we will just discuss about some the metabolic complications in the thalassemia major. This is one of the major problem when the patient comes into the second decade of life in the teenage. We have multiple problems, starting from the short stature, which is around in 1/3 of the patient. We have the diabetes, hypoparathyroidism, hypothyroidism, and gonadism, hypogonadism seen around the 40% of the patients. So it's a wide variety of the metabolic complications seen in the thalassemia patient. And that's the right now is the true fact that still we cannot overcome this problem. There are a multifactorial reason for this one, like in the growth deficiency, stunt growth. Many factors are there. Underlying is partly of the chronic anemia and hypoxia, hypersplenism. So lot of factor involving and led to this one growth deficiency, growth decrease in the growth, especially as well as the desferoxamine toxicity, which led to the earlier closure of the epiphyses and the is overall reduction in the height and weight. So need the close monitoring you have to, and the management is not just only to just give the supplement. You have to identify the cause, because it might have a multiple endocrine abnormalities. It could be the hypothyroidism, hypogonadism, as well as the growth hormone deficiency. So you treat each and every cause. If patient have the desferoxamine, you just have to stop. It might be their side effect. And you can give the growth hormone supplement earlier on, as well as some zinc supplement, because with deferiprone you have the zinc deficiency as well. These are the hypothyroidism that is also seen around the 10% of the patient. This is how we manage it. If we in the mild and the overt hypothyroidism, where we have the elevated TSH is there, then you have to treat with the thyroxine. Is fairly treatable condition, and patient do not have a major issue with this generally. Hypoparathyroidism, yeah, this is sometimes the major problem. The patient came with a weakness, hypocalcemia, like in generalized malaise, fatigue, and in extreme cases it can have led to the tetany as well as arrhythmia. Generally they presented with the hypocalcemia with high phosphate, parathyroid hormone level might be low or normal, with the low vitamin D level. I never come across, but it's my observation, vitamin D I found is an almost 60-70% Omani population have a low vitamin D, regardless whether they are the thalassemia or the normal people. So these are the management is, and we generally give the vitamin D majority of these patient in, and you can give this in calcitriol, which is also the vitamin D analog. In severe cases where the serum calcium is in less than 1.5 or the symptomatic patient, you can urgently give the IV calcium gluconate. Thalassemia and pregnancy. This is an actually is a very complex issue. I just have to cut short the story, because I will not involve in the counseling session. They need actually counseling as well before. But this is an, because in the right now is an improvement in the overall thalassemia care. So our patient right now, they have an increased survival. Generally we can see the thalassemia patient, major patient, they can survive up to the age of the 40 years. So we have one patient, she is in around 38 years, the eldest one. So this is an, our mean age is around 20 plus. So this is the improvement. Now this issue come across more oftenly, and it's depending, it's needed is a close liaison between the lot of people you have to have, and we have to do the detailed thorough workup. Before that, we have to evaluate that is patient is eligible for the pregnancy, what we have to do. That which patient we say then we go for the, who should go for the pregnancy. So these are the certain parameters they have to do, like in heart monitoring is very important. You have to have an echocardiogram, ECG, you make sure that patient do not have a severe iron overload or the poor ejection fraction or the arrhythmia, because the pregnancy might put an additional burden on it. Liver monitoring as well, is when LFTs, especially if patient have a viral infection, hepatitis C. So you have to be make sure that this it should be under control, otherwise there is a risk of the transfusion, in utero transfusion to the neonates. Endocrine, yes, it should be managed. Thrombophilia screening, it should be done in the thalassemia major or intermediate, because these patients might need an ovarian stimulation, so they are at risk of the thrombosis. And certain things are, the iron overload is very important, that is very crucial, that those who is planning for the pregnancy, they should have to be adhere to the iron chelation, and preferably is the IV desferoxamine. So you have to bring down their serum ferritin level, at least is in 1000, near 1000 microgram per liter. Partner status, yeah, it should be needed, need for the counseling purpose, healthy lifestyle, as well as you have to review of the drugs, that what patient she is taking the medication, like in hormone replacement therapy, if warfarin switched to the heparin, if is on hydroxyurea is stopped, if on the oral hypoglycemic you change to the is the insulin. So these certain drugs you have to look at it and give the appropriate advice before patient planning for the pregnancy. And this is how we go about it. There are certain ovulation induction protocol, and that you have to behave because this patient need and close monitoring by the gynecologist, obstetrician, and the need and serial scan as well as during the cycles. So this is how we think about it. And the risk associated with the pregnancy, the only risk, increased risk of the in the pregnancy is then cardiac complication if they are not well chelated. And generally we avoid the iron chelation during the first trimester, though it's safe, desferoxamine, still we avoid. So that lag period is, and that's why we want that patient should be better iron chelated. So we have the liberty to stop few weeks during that early period. So this is the one other, as well as the preterm labor and the fetal growth retardation, it is slight increase in incidence as compared with the normal population. But rest of the things are comparable with the normal population. Risk of isoimmunization is as comparable. But since they are getting the transfusions more frequent during the pregnancy, so you have to take in care of it. That is an might and baby have an develop if patient is an OH negative and she developed the reaction. So RH fetal can be happened. Transplant. Yes, transplant in thalassemia major is the definite curative treatment options. Actually, it was started in the 1981 by the Italian group, and since then more than 1500 transplant has been performed. Even in our region, in the Eastern Mediterranean region, so far around more than 200 plus transplant being done in the hemoglobinopathies, including the sickle cell as well as thalassemia. This is the only issue on the transplant is that we have to monitor three factors that have the outcome on the transplant outcome, especially the iron chelations, if patient is properly, adequately iron chelating, liver fibrosis and hepatomegaly. On the basis of it, we divided this patient into three classes. This is how I can tell you about the class 1, 2 and 3 patient, where the class 1 who have the no risk out of these three, while class 3 have all the three risk factors are there. So you can just see then how much is an event-free survival, which is 91%, fairly very good. It goes up to the 58% in the class 3. While is the rejection rate is the class 3 is an 1/3 patient, they're being rejected around 28%. And also the transplant related mortality is very high. So that this transplant, we have to carefully select the patient. Ideally, it should be done from the HLA matched identical siblings. And about the transplant, we can say then there are some studies. If the we do the transplant after the age of 16, the rejection rate and the transplant related mortality will be very high because of the increase of the iron overload in the system. You know how much is the transplant cost in Oman? Ideally, somewhere is 50,000 if in non-complicated, is in $50,000. So it's an very expensive, but it's one of the curative. So whenever is the feasibility is there, we go for the transplant. Pardon? Yes, the only issue is then because we don't have the enough. Maybe in the next few years, this new center will be there. So there will be more transplant. This is the thing, other investigation therapy. We have a lot of things about the hypomethylating agent, especially azacitidine, decitabine. These are actually the methyl, they just suppress the methylation. So they open the gene for the replications. They might, actually we tried in the some diseases like in the MDS. So there are some studies going on which might have a beneficial effect in the thalassemia. The only issue is then because these drugs are the, after all is the chemotherapy, so they might have a mutagenic effect. This is the problem with it. Hydroxyurea used only in thalassemia intermedia and sickle cell disease. As such, no role in thalassemia major. These last two, which I would, especially about the JAK2 inhibitor and the hepcidin administration. If we go back to the pathogenesis, we said JAK2 inhibitor is basically the proliferative signaling pathway is there. So what happened, I told you, in the ineffective erythropoiesis, if you look at it, the marrow actually is the is full of cells, is an expand. It's because of the erythropoietin drive, Jake state pathway is there. So that led to the erythroid expansion. And that led to the extramedullary hemoptysis as well as the splenomegaly. So this is having one of the hypothetical mechanisms. Since we are using in polycythemia vera and myelofibrosis, where we have the extramedullary hematopoiesis and the huge spleen, and it's quite reduced the size of the spleen. So it might have a beneficial effect. If we reduce the proliferation, that might help in the reduce the extramedullary expansion as well as the spleen size, which might decrease the transferrin requirement. And the hepcidin has a role in the iron. Is then hepcidin have a negative feedback on the iron? If low hepcidin, we have the increased iron absorption from the body. So that might be in the future some trial going on where you can use the hepcidin agonist to increase the level of the hepcidin that decrease the iron transfer, iron absorption from the whole body. Partial blood exchange is might not isn't because this is the in the thalassemia major is the problem is the different as compared with the sickle cell disease. Here our aim is then, which I say then, what is our aim in the thalassemia is not only to we give the super transfusion, we want to build the hemoglobin above 13 to 14 gram in order to suppress their own erythropoiesis. While in the sickle cell, our target is something different, where we bring down the hemoglobin S rather than to improve the hemoglobin. So it's not going to helpful. Gene therapy is another area where this more trial going on. The only problem is in that we identify the gene, we know is in the, especially the promoter region in the LCR, is called the locus control region. But then how to insert this gene into the stem cell. So this trial going on, especially they are using some lentivirus, retroviral, they are using it. So it's hopefully it's then it will be the future. Stem cell transfusion is the transplant that I said is then. That's the allogenic. Here in the gene therapy, what they are going to do it is then they take the patient's own stem cell and they are the transfected with the lentiviral, retroviral, which is mounted with this gene, promoter gene. So that led to the downward extreme, this one is the amplification of the beta gene downstream. So this is how it's going on. The only problem is not, is still there are some error and omissions, and there are some also is the ethical issues as well as involved is then. Because there is, so there's some, you are the better people that what are the ethical issues when you are transfecting the gene, is then there is an also viral gene. So in the offspring that might lead to the mutagenesis in the future offspring as well. So about the summary, I still is then thalassemia or the hemoglobinopathy is an heterogeneous group of disorders, and it's an very common disorder throughout the world. Around a great majority of people are affected. It has a major economic burden on the health expenditure of the government of these blood diseases. On an average, in the conventional treatment, we just have to spend around 1,000 to 1,500 Omani rial to maintain 1 month of the patients, including the transfusion administration and the drug. It's a major economical issues for the government. And we should have a further research in pathogenesis of the disease, and we have to develop some new techniques that how to address that, how to avoid the transfusion, and especially the how to decrease the iron accumulations is there. So this is my thank you very much.
Thank you.